Hi everyone, hope everyone's doing well. So nice to be talking to all of you again. And this week I am extremely excited because we have one of my favorite people who are going to be joining us. I'm going to get her on and then I'm going to do an introduction. She's going to be joining us in just a minute. Hi, Shaheen, how are you?
Hi, Kat, how are you?
That worked well. I'm so proud of myself. Every time we've been doing this, it's been taking so long to get someone on. So now I'm learning. So everyone, I'm going to do a quick introduction of Shaheen. So Shaheen is the author of an incredible book, I've Never Been Unhappier. This is an extremely important book, which we're going to talk about in a bit. But first of all, I just want to welcome you all to Self-Care with K-Beauty, which is what we're all doing here today. And we're going to be talking to Shaheen a bit about her book club, which she's also just started, called the Shiny Happy Book Club, which I absolutely love the name of. And it's so cute. I went on the page a few days back and I was looking at the whole page. So Shaheen, welcome and thanks for being with us today. Thanks for coming and joining us. And we would just love to know a little bit about the book club and if you could just tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, so basically, so I started a page called Here Comes the Sun last year in October. And Shiny Happy Book Club is sort of a collaboration between Here Comes the Sun and another page called Books on Toast. And it's basically... the reason that we did it was because we realized collectively, at least for me, you know, reading has had such a massive impact on my mental health. It's played such a huge part in my journey. It's one of the things, it's my massive coping mechanism. I started reading Harry Potter when I was 11 and it became like a massive way that I dealt with all the stuff that was going on with me. And so we realized what a difference it actually makes to your mental health. And so we decided to start a book club that basically it just marries the idea of reading and mental health. So the idea is that we get a curator on board every month who recommends like a nonfiction book and one fiction book, anything that basically helps you with your mental health. So this month we have Rohan Joshi, who is our curator, and he's recommended some great books.
Yeah, he's amazing. He's too much fun. Yeah. I'd be really interested to know if we just kind of... if we can kind of explain to everyone about how you feel in your experience with how books have kind of helped you and what you feel about books kind of in this time. You know, I think I know I've kind of heard you discuss it before. And I think a lot of us feel the same way, that this lockdown is a little bit like a pause. It's a pause from the regular rhythm, whatever that rhythm is, for different rhythms for different people. And instead of looking at it as something bad or something, you know, has happened, we can see it as an opportunity and also take that as a way that will allow us to focus on things that we don't normally focus on or that we don't get time to focus on. I know that you've also spoken a lot, as you just said, about how reading has helped you a lot at different points in your life and in different times in your life. Before we get to that, though, I would love if you could just share a little bit with us and with all everyone who's joining us today about your book, Never Been Unhappier. I know when I first read this book, it was a while back now, but when I first read the first few chapters, it really kind of hit me. In fact, I kind of had to take breaks and kind of, you know, process it, because there's some really, really important things that you've said in the book. And I think right now more than... always relevant, but especially right now, I think there's some really relevant things that you address in the book.
Yeah, so I mean, you know, we've talked about this. It's, I think, now more than ever, even people who've never experienced anxiety or depression are probably going through it for the first time, because we're in a very weird and unprecedented situation. Nothing like this has ever happened before, so it's only natural that people are going to be going through that, you know, phase of uncertainty. For me, my book is basically about my entire journey with depression. I started like experiencing depression when I was 12, which has now been pretty much my entire adult life that, you know, I've sort of dealt with depression. And my book just basically goes through what my experience and my understanding of living with depression for that long is. So I try to talk about as much personal experience as I can. I've got my diary scans in there, because for me, that's like, it's an easy way to sort of show rather than actually just tell. It's for me, like showing you actually bits and pieces of like when I was going through an episode, what I was thinking and how I was feeling
at that time.
At that time. And I think my, you know, the crux of my book is basically, you know, acceptance. It's one of the reasons that I've been able to sort of deal with what I have going on is the fact that I've accepted it. I've learned that it's a part of my life. I don't know if it's going to go away completely. And so far, it hasn't in my life. And it's something that I manage on an ongoing basis. And the fact that I've accepted that gives me a much better outlook on it. Like, I know how to deal with it better now because I've actually accepted it as a part of my life.
There's one thing that I've heard you kind of talk about before. I think I read it in maybe one of the articles which you've done, or maybe on one of the blogs which you've done, where you spoke about something that fear of the unknown is really what causes the worry and anxiety, because we're worried about something that we don't know about. It's not in our control. And there's something that you kind of discussed was a good way of dealing with that worry and the negative thoughts is to kind of ask yourself and question yourself that, is the worry rational or helpful? Like, for example, I think you've given an example that you can't control the virus, right? We don't know exactly what is going to happen. It's an unknown. Yeah. So how much worry about that is even, you know, useful or helpful to us? I'd just really be interested to hear a little bit about what you, you know, kind of how you.
Yeah.
You
so, that. I mean, what's interesting to me is that human beings were the only creatures that actually think of the future. There's not a single other animal on this planet that actually imagines the future or hypothesizes about the future or wonders about the future. We're literally the only living creature that thinks about the future with our imagination, and we create a whole bunch of what ifs and thousands
possible
of scenarios. What might happen, and usually, especially in a situation like this, they tend to be pretty scary. They're not good. The what ifs are not really good what ifs because there's so many things that we don't know about. And so I find that really fascinating that human beings are like that. And you know, the thing, like exactly what you said, I think what really helps me is to take my fears and say, okay, is this a rational fear or is it a helpful fear? Irrational fear or helpful fear? Irrational fear is like if you're worried about a plane crash or a terrorist attack, there's nothing you can do about that. But if I'm worried about, oh, I have a work presentation tomorrow, that's something I can actually do something about. So for me, what helps me is to, if I put them in these two little piles, then I go, okay, this one pile, I can't actually do anything about this one pile. I can't do anything about the virus. I'm not a doctor. I can't fix that. The only thing I can do is focus on the things that I have control over and influence over. So even if that means I'm worried about the impact that the virus is having on people around me and people who are struggling, what way can I help them? It might be a small way. I might not be able to fix the problem and cure world hunger, but I can fix it in whatever small way that I can manage, and that's good enough. So for me, I just focus on the bits of influence that I can exert, and I try to do that.
Rather than getting overwhelmed with the bigger picture.
Yeah, I think
that's
exactly.
That's where we can sometimes get lost in, is the possible scenarios that we create in our mind. That almost becomes real for us. And I think that, before you know it, it's pulled you into an outcome which probably will never happen. Like I read somewhere on one of my favorite authors had written that, you know, most of the things we worry about never happen. Most of the bad and negative scenarios that we obsess about in our heads, they never happen. So I think what you said about focusing and kind of dividing it into piles of what we can actually do something about and what we can't, I think that's a really helpful way. I just wanted to jump back to the Shiny Happy Book Club a bit, and I just wanted to ask you about some of the titles that maybe we can just talk a little bit about them, because I know there's a lot of people who like me and my sisters, and it's in our group chat, we always, everyone's discussing, please recommend a book, please recommend a book. I'm like, you guys just got 5 recommendations like a few days back. Yeah, we're done those. It's an amazing book called Jonathan Living Siegel. So I just wanted to know a little bit about that book.
Yeah, so Jonathan Livingston Seagull was recommended by Sonam. Sonam Kapoor was our curator last month, so she recommended it. It's a book that I've read when I was like 15. So I've read it a really, really long time ago. Mm-hmm. And I mean, so the thing with that book is, you know, I feel like in this day and age, the ideas that that book talks about are things that we kind of know. But I think at the time it was quite radical almost in a way, because it's basically talking about the entire premise is about a seagull who decides that he doesn't sort of want to conform to the normal seagull way of living, and he just wants to keep flying higher and higher, and he leaves the flock. And it's basically about not, you know, conforming and, you know, pushing yourself and, you know, learning how to go higher by, you know, accepting who you are and accepting that you're not part of the regular flock. So it's a really nice and uplifting book.
Yeah, it's I think that's a very short book that, you know, people can read during this time. It's something that has been on my to-read list for a while. The other one is one of your recommendations is The Hitchhiker's Guide to Galaxy.
So The Hitchhiker's Guide to Galaxy is also, it's a classic. It's a bizarre book, but it's one of my favorite books. Again, I started reading it when I was like 14 or 15. And basically it is a book about the premise of the book. It literally starts with the Earth is being demolished to create an interspace highway. That is the premise of the book. That is the premise of the book, but it's hilarious. It is so funny. It is, it's one of those things that it just takes you out of your, whatever your day-to-day, whatever your worries are. It's one of the few books that I've read and actually laughed out loud on pretty much every single page. So one of the reasons I recommended that book is just because it makes you, it's such a feel-good book. It just makes you feel happy and it's bizarre. And that's what I love about it. In some places, it makes no sense, but it's just really frivolous and good fun.
Amazing. The other one that was kind of an interesting title, which I was wondering what that one was about, was called Reason to Stay Alive.
So Reasons to Stay Alive is a book by one of my favorite authors. His name is Matt Haig. It's also about his journey with depression. And basically what he had done was when he was dealing with depression, he started a blog, or after he sort of dealt with it, he started a blog called Reasons to Stay Alive, where he sort of listed all the reasons that he felt like he should stay alive, despite the fact that he was having, you know, having such a hard time mentally and emotionally. And it's, again, a really, it's a very easy read. It's a short book. But it's so beautifully and succinctly explains depression and, you know, emotional states that you might not understand, any kind of fear, any kind of anxiety. It explains it so beautifully. And it's so profound in its sense of like acceptance and sort of accepting the fact that this is, you know, ups and downs are a part of life and transience is a part of life. That it's one of the few books that really, really helped me process what I was dealing with by myself.
Amazing. Then there was one book which I think pretty sure I got the top, The Brain.
Yeah.
So The Brain, explanatory, but
The Brain, the story of you, that's Rohan's recommendation for this month. It's his recommendation. One of his recommendations for this month is the nonfiction. And I've just started reading it. And again, it's really, you know, the reason that he's picked it, he said, was because he finds that it's really nice for you to understand what your mind, like how complex your mind is. And once you understand the complexity of your mind, you're more likely to just cut yourself some slack, because you kind of realize the crazy amount of things that your brain is processing, the way that it's dealing with things. And I've just started reading it, and it's really, really fascinating. It, you know, it just talks about the idea of consciousness, the idea of you, the way that you process things around you, you know, how, why we need to be around other people, why human beings crave attachment. So many different things, but it's such a simple thing, and we actually never think about the thing that causes the things that we think about.
Yeah, the thing that causes the most trouble. We don't really want to just accept it for what it is. I agree with you there. So that's some really interesting recommendations. So guys, I really recommend that you check out the Shiny Happy Book Club on Instagram. I'm also going to be putting a story on it after. So in case you miss it out here, you can just do a swipe up, and that's going to take you to that page, and you can see some of these amazing book recommendations. One thing I wanted to ask you about also, Shaneen, was, I know we've spoken in the past a little bit about mindfulness versus meditation. Now, although meditation is amazing, and I know a lot of people for whom it's magical, I know that you had mentioned in the past, like, meditation is not something really which works for you, whereas you practice something which is called more mindfulness. And I was really that we're interested, because I know there are a lot of people who feel that way. So if you could just kind of just the way you explained to me a bit about how you practice mindfulness.
Yeah. So basically, I mean, I'm one of those people, if you say meditation, it scares me off. My brain is on fast forward all the time. It's got 100 things going on. I so far haven't been able to sort of master the knack of sitting and observing my mind even for a minute. It's not something that I'm able to really do quite easily. And so this is also something I started doing when I noticed that I was in like a worry spiral. If I'm in a spiral of negative thoughts that are not shutting down, you need a way to like stop the thoughts. You need a way to arrest them and just be able to stop them. So what I do is I will just sit by myself and I will close my eyes first. and I will focus on 5 things that I can hear. Then I will focus on 5 things that I can feel, you know. So even if that's my, like right now, that's my foot on the ground. That's the feeling of the cloth on my skin. I can feel the chair. So 5 things that I can feel. And then I will open my eyes and 5 things that I can see. And from 5 all the way down to 1, I will keep counting them down. So from 5 things, it'll go to 4 things, to 3 things, to 2 things, and to 1 thing, until finally what happens is it just arrests, it stops that thought process of me being in a spiral, and it's completely centered me, like, in the now. So I'm only focusing on the things that I can see, the things that I can hear, and the things that I can feel. So that's like my tiny version of meditation, because I, like, it's what I do on planes, actually, because I'm a horribly anxious flyer. And I get very, very stressed out when I'm on planes. Mm-hmm. So on planes, that's the way I like, that's the easiest way for me to calm myself down, is because it slows my breathing down. It makes me feel very zen. So that's my version.
I've read this as well. Just very recently, actually, I heard about this on, because, you know, a lot of different pages and a lot of Instagram handles are putting, you know, information about different tips and ways you can deal with anxiety during this time. And this was actually one of the main things which I read, that I've been reading in a few places, that if you focus on something, you know, that's in front of you, just an object or, you know, something a few feet maybe in front of you, and you focus all your attention there, and then you gradually expand it to just kind of what's surrounding until you kind of focus on the whole room. It pulls you and your mind into now and not into the scenarios and the thoughts which are going on in your mind. So that's, I think that's something really, really important that you kind of shared with us. The other thing that a lot of people on the comments have been asking about meditation and whether I do meditation. I actually do meditation, and you know, the way that I was able to kind of get into it slowly was actually using an app. So again, I'm going to be putting a swipe up story on the page later about some of the apps which you can use, which just are very simple and baby steps that can kind of help you just to calm your mind and take you into meditation if that's something you want to practice. Shaheen, thank you so much for talking to us, and I hope you're doing well and staying safe. And thank you so much, and good luck with the book club. It sounds incredible, and I absolutely love the page. And hopefully we'll see you soon as this lockdown.
We will, when it's at some point, eventually when this is over, we will hang.
Bye, babe. Thank you. Bye, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us. And stay home and stay safe and take care of your family and those around you. Bye, everyone.